Welcome back to Movie Recap. Today I'm gonna show you a 2019 Chinese fantasy drama film called Super Me. Spoilers ahead. Seat back, relax and enjoy. The movie begins with the protagonist, Sangyu, practicing the art of sleeping on his feet on a crowded subway train. He fails almost immediately as he wakes up from a quick shut-eye. Sangyu hasn't been able to sleep soundly in months. He thought that he had schizophrenia, although he looked like and dressed like one, that wasn't really the case. Sangyu just happens to be unique. Special in a way that he would soon discover, that he has the ability to alter reality in a different dimension, and bring physical objects to the present. But that's for later. For now, he is approached by a tall bipedal figure emitting a dark aura. People scream as the figure walks toward Sangyu. He seems to be stuck and can't get away. The figure now runs towards him, grabs his hair, and bangs it to the train floor. As his head hits the train floor, he wakes up from the nightmare, panting and short of breath. Sangyu tries to process what happened. It seems surreal. He wonders if it was indeed a nightmare as he recovers from the morning grogginess. As soon as Sangyu wakes up, he checks his phone. As usual, nothing good. Sanji, an editor he works for, tried calling him a few times for an unmet writing contract. To make matters worse, his landlord violently knocks on the door, doing what landlords do best, trying to collect rent. Without a care in the world, Sangyu lights a cigarette and smokes his worries away. Afterward, he leaves the apartment through the window so that he can avoid the landlord. In the next scene, Sangyu tries to consult different experts of their respective fields in order to find the true purpose of life, and the meaning behind his nightmares. According to one expert, dreams are the way to the subconscious. Only in dreams can a person go to the unlighted corners of the mind, and find their true selves. Sangyu also approached a shaman who explained that existence is tied to fate. Next, Sangyu approaches a street food stall and orders a Chinese crepe with no egg. While waiting for it to be served, he stares into the coffee shop on the other side of the street. It's managed and owned by Hua, a girl who had the longest crush on. He met her during his college days, back when he had the tackiest bowl cut. She used to sing for a band, and he always remembers how she sang beautifully on that fated night. She was his escape from the harsh reality, his joie de vivre. As Sangyu prepares to eat his fresh food, Sanji runs into him. This made Sangyu panic as he hadn't worked on anything yet. As talented as he is with writing, he is that bad at running. Sangyu eventually catches up and brings Sangyu to a noodle shop to talk. Sangyu explains that he is experiencing writer's block, a creative slowdown due to his insomnia. Sangyu lets out his frustration by slapping Sangyu in the head, reminding him not to make any excuses, stop being lazy and pull himself together. He then leaves without looking back. Sangyu climbs back up to his runny apartment only to find his window tied shut. Unable to go by the window, he goes to what ordinary guys do when trying to enter their apartment, by the door, upon arriving on his floor. He sees his things outside the door, and his eviction is long overdue. Now homeless, Sangyu tries to write material on his damaged laptop. He can't focus due to hunger. He tries to eat a leftover but is beaten to it by a stranger. This stranger turned out to be the shadowy figure who attacked him in one of his nightmares, and it tried to kill him again. Like the first encounter, it turned out to be a nightmare. He wakes up all dazed and confused. He tried to look for his laptop but figured out that it was stolen while he dozed off on top of being broke, homeless and hungry. Sangyu lost his only way of working and recovering from his current situation. Man, talk about bad luck. Losing all hope, he tries to commit suicide by jumping off a building. The man managing the street food stall sees him and offers him food. This small gesture of charity prevented Sangyu from jumping. The man consoles Sangyu and provides an advice that will bring him good fortune. When everything seems lost, stay enthusiastic by saying, "This is all a dream." This advice would save him multiple times later on. Anyways, Sangyu sells his keypad phone for 20 yuan and buys himself food at the convenience store. As he munches on the cheap junk food, he gets attacked again by the shadowy figure again. So much for a quiet meal. It turns out that the shadowy figure was a blue ogre. The ogre drives a sword through Sangyu's stomach. One second, he was on an empty stomach, and now, instead of food, there's a sword piercing through it. Sangyu remembers the man from the food stall's advice and shouts out, "This is only a dream." The shadowy figure dissipated, but the golden sword remained. Unable to realize reality from illusion, he runs off to an empty park with the golden sword in hand. He tries to slap himself to see if he is indeed awake. Tired from all the madness, he dozed off. Not soon after, morning came, and he spurs from his catnap. With the golden sword in hand, he realizes he can sell the weaponry. He first approached a street-level buyer but admitted he was being ripped off, and so he came to a pawn shop instead. There he was able to make a profit of 20,000 yuan. Not bad for a sword he acquired by dreaming. Afterward, like any broke ass who gets instantly rich, he spends money almost immediately by eating at a fancy restaurant and staying at a luxury hotel. It was a game changer for the young man. He shaves off the hideous goatee and treats himself by buying expensive products. Back at the hotel, he tries to sleep comfortably. But what's comfort without a bit of discomfort, right? He experiences the same problem again. An encounter with the blue ogre. Only this time, the ogre attacks him with a golden two-handed axe. He gets wounded at the shoulder, and in a state of adrenaline, he says the magic words to get him out, "It is only a dream." He wakes up with the golden axe and laughs hysterically, knowing he can sell the golden axe, which he did. Another confrontation with the blue ogre ensues. This time he's confident. He had faced off with the blue skin fiend a few times, and he now can control his interactions in his dreamlike state. He grabs different loads of treasures, and wakes up by saying the magic word. After selling the golden axe, Songyu buys expensive clothing, and dances his way to different stores. He should have stuck to things he's good at and skipped dancing. Coincidentally, his old pal and boss, Songyu, run into him. He tries to run off, but then remembers that he can pay off Songyu. So, he invites him to dinner. During their meal, Songyu paid Songyu back. Gaining confidence in himself, he gathers his strength and courage to visit the girl of his dreams, Huar. He approached the counter where she was busy fixing the coffee machine. He was always daydreaming of this moment, and now, it's finally coming true. He couldn't believe it. Huar has a way with her words. The way she spoke was subtle, but dreamlike. Monotonous yet heartwarming. To Songyu, it was magical, and he was willing to do anything to be her man. Later that day, Songyu meets with Songyu, and the old pals have too much to drink. Songyu carries a passed out drunk Songyu back to his apartment and into his bed. Without warning, Songyu is having another episode, and wakes up with golden chains in hand. Songyu witnessed the whole thing, and believes that God has given his old hired artisan some sort of superpower as a form of reward for all the suffering he had prior. Songyu begs Songyu to be partners. He begged on his knees. Knowing Songyu's goofy yet honest personality, Songyu accepts. Technically the duo is now partners in crime. Songyu continues to try and impress Huar by saving her coffee shop from financial ruin, giving her a Gran Turismo Maserati, arranging a grand firework display just for her, and fixing an award show. Pretty much anything money can buy, no matter the exaggeration. Fake it till you make it, right? With money, fame, influence, and power, he didn't let his ego get the better of him. He was living a lavish lifestyle, but he was more enlightened and philosophical with the approach to life. The partners Songyu and Songyu were about to change the world for the better using the accumulated wealth. But as the saying goes, what goes around comes around. Nothing is free in this world, and Songyu was receiving the backlash of his supernatural ability. The wounds he got from the ogre slowly appeared, and this made him think that he shouldn't involve Huar in his misfortune. He bolts and tries hard to ignore Huar. As the millennials would say, he ghosts her. On the same night, Songyu retires to his bed. He tells Songyu that he prefers sleeping alone that night and that he did. As he enters REM sleep, he enters into an altered reality of his consciousness. It's like a completely different dimension, yet he was there, not there as he reached the summit of subliminal reality in the form of a high skyscraper. He spots the exact shadowy figure who has been haunting and somewhat rewarding him multiple times in the past. He approaches the shadowy figure, and as he comes to face it, he sees himself. It was a complete reflection of himself. His alter ego, a vivant of his very being. The doppelganger slowly fades into the void, signifying that he would meet the same fate. Scared for his life, he wakes up. It was another nightmare. Fresh wounds slowly manifest. To make matters worse, a group of hooligans kidnaps the young protagonist. The culprit? Well, it's the pawn shop owner whom he sold the first few treasures. The villains extort Songyu to the point that they forcefully kidnap Songyu and Huar. The gang of delinquents soon discover Songyu's hidden treasures in an underground room. Well, it was too big to be a room, but let's just call it that. Anyways, as the movie progresses, Songyu dies protecting Songyu as they make their escape, and later Huar dies from bullet wounds. The same fate meets the gang of criminals as Songyu suffers the loss of his pal and the love of his life. He convinces himself that this is only a dream like any misfortune and encounter with the blue ogre. He wakes up from the worst nightmare yet. He seemed happy to have gone back in time, to the part where he sold his phone to have food to eat. Hua approaches the distressed Songyu and offers him something to eat. Committed to turning his life around and no longer depending on his unique ability, Songyu slowly tries to improve his situation and recover from poverty. He currently works for Hua in her coffee shop. For a man who used to have everything, this was simple yet satisfying to the soul. He couldn't be any happier. The movie ends with Songyu satisfied with what he has. He tries to purchase food from the same food stall across the street. As Songyu approaches, the older man hands him a bag full of cash. It was the same bag that Songyu gave the old man secretly, thanking him for his life advice. The old man reveals that he also sold his soul in exchange for money. Yet, he learned the same lesson that Songyu recently learned. Happiness can't be achieved by wealth or mundane things, but absolute joy is found in the little things. Thank you for watching. Subscribe for more videos like this to help the channel out. Have a nice day.